Welcome to Suffolk Matters, where all of Suffolk County meets the men and women of Suffolk AME. News, opinions, and insights you won't hear anywhere else. Here's your host, the president of New York's largest independent union, Suffolk AME's Dan Levler.
Welcome to another edition of Suffolk Matters on Walk 97.5 and 94.3 The Shark, where Suffolk County meets the men and women of Suffolk AME. News and views you can't hear anywhere else.
So my guest this morning is Assemblyman Joe DeStefano. Good morning, Joe.
Good morning, Dan. It's been great. It's been a great time in Albany, and I'm glad to be back.
That was going to be one of my first questions. You know, we have you on the show often, and that's primarily because of two things. One, obviously, you know, you're an assemblyman, you're doing the job, but you have a long history with AME also, so you know us, you know our process, you know our values. And, you know, it's just very important for us to touch base with you to see, you know, how one of us, so to speak, is handling all of the circus in Albany right now. You know, I mean, this is a very odd year. Times that you would normally be in session, you're not. Now, times that you would normally be out of session, it looks like you guys are going to be in quite a bit.
Well, actually, every time they call us back in, it's always about a theme. When this first started with the Zoom conferencing and things like that, it was because of the COVID virus, which it was it needed to be done. We needed to get up there and take some votes to help the people who are being affected by the virus. Then it was those awful law enforcement bills that they brought forward that really hurt our law enforcement community. On Thursday, it was all about the elections. You know, what we're going to do to make the elections better. So that was the theme of this week's arrival up in Albany.
Yeah, this could just keep going on. There could be new themes and things could keep going. But, you know, I mean, one of the things in this past week that came up was automatic voter registration. So, you know, what does that do?
Well, it doesn't do any good things for us. What it does, basically, it allows people to go to various places like the Department of Labor, Social Services, the Board of Elections, which you can always have done it there. But what it does basically is it automatically registers you to vote unless you opt out. Now, I don't know, I don't know at this moment how that's going to affect the voting registration process. But in my opinion, I think the theory of what they were trying to do is trying to get more voter participation. What I'm afraid might happen is that possibly the minority communities that, that aren't or undercounted or whatever, they may not want to vote. They may not want to put their name out there for whatever reason. That's unfortunate. I think that I'm a believer, you know, I'm a guy who kind of plays the middle of the road kind of a thing. And I believe that every vote should count. But, you know, there's places that you can go that may affect, that may help other parties within the voting process. They may make no mention of, you know, places like hunting and fishing where you get your licenses. Sometimes those licenses are more expensive than getting your driver's license, which is also one of those voter registration places. There really are no safeguards into this as to, you know, what it is that's going to help the voting process. There's no penalties, and if you vote illegally, they're just going to say you weren't supposed to do that. There's nothing to say that if you go and vote automatically, or you get registered to vote automatically, if you do it with the wrong reasons or wrong intentions, that there's any penalties for it. They talk about it, but there's no enforcement of it. If you don't put your signature on it, they're going to call you. They're going to try and get in touch with you and say, listen, your signature, we need your signature. Please come back. And you have up to, I believe it's 7 days maybe or whatever, to come back and fix it. There's another bill if you want to talk about down the road about if your vote gets tabulated or it doesn't get tabulated and gets thrown out during the process of when there's a recount or something like that. They're going to send you a letter saying that your vote isn't being counted. You have up to 7 days now to come and fix that vote that they already threw out. So there's some kind of a deliberate thing going on that, is not good. You know, I understand some people make mistakes. We all make mistakes. We're all human. But, you know, it's one of those things where, you know, it seems like there's a specific reason why we're going out of our way, especially the part about opting out. You we had a conference call yesterday during this process, and one of the things is that if you're, and the example was, if you have a passport or if you have a documentation from a foreign country, we'll use Greece, for example, because that was the example that was used. And you go to motor vehicle and you get automatically voted, you get automatically registered because you produced a passport or something from Greece. Your information gets automatically sent to the Board of Elections, and unless you sign opt out, you're getting registered to vote. And to me, that's the checks and balances that we're going to miss in this bill. Because if that person is not eligible because they're not a citizen, they should not be automatically registered to vote.
Yeah, I mean, I have questions, you know. I mean, how about party affiliation, right? So you just automatically get registered to vote, but do they dump you into a particular party? I mean, what if you don't select one?
Well, you have to select one, but they're going to be told that if you do not check a party affiliation, you cannot vote in primaries. That's the only notification you're going to be given, is that if you don't check a party affiliation, you're not going to be eligible to vote in a primary. Other than that, it's all bets are off.
And so if you're not educated and aware, your individual choice is basically, it's not there. Like, you're just opted in.
Correct. Absolutely correct.
Yeah, I could see why some people may want to not register to vote. You know, it's my belief that we should all participate in this process. As many people as possible should be aware of the issues, in touch with, not just their representative, but, you know, have a sense of what their community needs are. But it isn't always practical. And, not everybody actually does this. You know, I mean, there are, in my impression, there are people who vote for who looked the best, right? You know, you get a palm card from two candidates and you take a look at their physical appearance and the appearance of the palm card, and you're like, you know what, this is the person I'm going to vote for. Some people are just, you know, well, listen, I'm this party affiliation. Everything that has that letter next to it, that's the box I'm going to check. But, some people don't want to be part of the process, conscientious objectors. And if they're not aware of the fact that they're, you know, automatically enrolled, they may just be, you know, blindly filling out paperwork, you know, checking some boxes and want to be on their way. And now they're enrolled.
Well, if you want to go back into the, I believe it was in the mid-90s when they did the motor voter registration that came up under Bill Clinton's administration, where they automatically were able to go to like a Department of Motor Vehicles. This bill actually goes a step further. That agency would assist you in registering to vote. This bill actually goes a step further and mandates that the agency apply for you on behalf of the applicant, meaning that they're going to make sure that you get registered to vote, where the other way, it was just to assist you in voting, you know, being registered to vote. This one actually makes the application for you to the department, to the Board of Elections.
Okay, so extra work for the workers doing the task, and then so how much is the state providing in additional funding for the extra work?
You know, Dan, that's always been my pet peeve, as you know, from the first day that we sat down and spoke. The unfunded mandates that absolutely are killing our local municipalities. Anything that comes out of Albany these days because of what's happening and the lack of funding coming in always comes with an unfunded mandate, and this happens to be one of them.
Yeah.
No money.
Yep. And it's been a regional problem. It's been a problem, when you look at in terms of being a donor county inside of a donor state, you know, Suffolk County gives more money to the state and to the federal government than it receives back in terms of aid. Right. So, you know, it always frustrates me. And I know, like, you know, firsthand because we've had these conversations, but it always frustrates me when our state representatives are very frustrated by the federal government for that exact same reason. And you say, well, OK, so the same exact thing that you just said applies to Suffolk County. Well, not really, because, you know, so that's absolutely a frustrating part of the process.
I know some of these bills that come out of Albany, it seems like they think that there's like a money tree in the backyard. And every time that, you know, we vote on something that puts an unfunded mandate on a local municipality, counties, towns, villages, state, whatever it may be, whatever organization it is, that you're going to have to find a way to pay for it. And to me, that's just it's unreasonable. It's something that should not go into effect. It should not take place until we say, okay, the state is going to give you XYZ amount of money to handle this new process. You know, Board of Elections, think about what that's going to do to them, you know, putting these things, and then there's all kinds of dates, and, you know, and there's more to this whole story. People really need to be informed about what it is that's going on, because it's going to challenge every bit of every working person in this county and in every other county in this state.
You're not wrong, Joe, but, you know, you touched on something there that I think is important for our listeners. If you could just give us the address of the money tree, because I think that's going to be important.
You know, Dan, and we sometimes joke a little bit about it, but right. it's really not funny, because, again, under these stressed times, as you know firsthand, dealing with all of the different agencies within Suffolk County that depend on the services that our members provide to everybody, think about that. You know, there's people now that are going to be taxed, even not taxed in the sense of paying more taxes, but are going to be taxed to the limits, which they already are. These people are already working more. They're working harder than they really should be, because they don't have the manpower, they don't have the resources, and yet we're going to be throwing more work on them. I mean, does this mean that possibly we're going to have to hire more people? I guess that's a good thing. But the bottom line is, if you're not going to give me any money to make that happen, then, you know, you're just taxing everybody else harder to do the job. And it's just, I guess it's a feel-good kind of thing for certain people that, oh, we're going to tell people, we're going to get them automatically registered to vote. And all they have to do is go to any one of the local agencies that are going to be doing this, the DMV, the social services, you know, the Department of Labor, any of those state-run agencies, they're going to be able to walk in there and be able to register automatically to vote.
Yeah.
You know, it's more work, you know, with no resources. That's where the bottom line is. That's where it comes down to.
And, you know, Joe, you talk about getting more jobs. You know, clearly more is asked of workers on a daily basis. And it gets to a point where you have a pretty clear-cut example of why. Like, you can demonstrate, okay, you know, we no longer have enough people to handle this function. You know, it was fine before. Yes, you have the same amount of people, but you've added, you know, 75% more work to the every day. You know, we need more people. And that's usually met with, well, we don't have money for that. You know, that's why they have to do extra work, is because we don't have money. But these are frontline workers that show up in a pandemic to make sure that, you know, you talk about the taxes, the taxpayer paid for these services in advance.
Right.
They've got to get them.
Absolutely.
Right? Like you paid for it already. So, you know, it's a very tricky balance here. But the need to get support from the state, the need to get support from the federal government, I think, is vital for our region.
Absolutely. One thing I do want to mention to you is that there, in some of these bills that just came out of Albany this week, there are timelines in enforced with a lot of these things. As you may or may not know, they are still counting primary votes. They're just calling some races now, but they're still, as of Thursday, this past Thursday, they are still counting ballots. Okay, so that's going to happen in the general election. You know, you're probably not going to know the winner on some of these races until maybe a week or two after the election. But again, that's overtaxing the workers that work in these facilities, because they don't have enough manpower to process these applications ahead of time. And there are the absentee ballots that they're going to automatically be sent. Everybody's going to get an absentee ballot registration form. That's the way it is right now, unless the governor changes it, which means those applications have to be processed, and there's a certain amount of time to get it done.
Yeah, and now it comes down to voter trust as well, right? You know, I cast my ballot a week ago. I've got to wait a month for the results. There's all these new things going on. You know, people were registered that maybe didn't want to be. Some of them maybe, you know, from your early example, maybe from a foreign country. You know, was this accurately recorded? You know, at a time of uncertainty, dumping uncertainty into the political process doesn't seem thought out.
Well, you also got to remember they changed the primary day, you know, and I am all for, and I'll go on record saying this, I am all for early voting and no excuse absentee ballot. I have absolutely no problem with any of that. I think it encourages. I actually voted early in the last election because I thought it was a great idea. I didn't have to sit online. Go to my polling place. I just go to the where the local polling place is for the town, And honestly speaking, I think that it gives people the latitude to, you know, go up to 10 days earlier than the actual election day, which to me, I mean, that's a home run. I mean, it actually encourages people who may not be able to get there on election day to go early and vote. So I am all for that.
So, Joe, another part of the process in government and elections and everything else is the opportunity to do redistricting, which on Correct. Paper could be a really good thing. You know, I mean, based on the concept of, you know, every 10 years or so, maybe there's population shifts, maybe there's, you know, whatever. So, you know, it's got its roots in something good. But in application, you know, what's the reality of it?
Well, I think that people want to be counted. I think for the most part, people want to be counted. New York, unfortunately, has had the distinction of being undercounted in a lot of redistricting efforts. That happens every 10 years.
Is that based off of census data?
Yes, the census. Okay. It absolutely goes off the census data, and that's how you lose congressional seats. That's how you lose legislative seats. There's a lot. I was going to get into it a little bit with you that, you know, they actually put in a redistricting plan back in 2015. Unfortunately, because this is the first census that's come up after that, they've never even tested the one that's already in place now. So they're already looking to change that before we even did the first one that they just agreed to. It looks like, it's a gerrymandering kind of a thing where they're gonna load the process up with restrictions on the minority party. And unfortunately, that's going to, you know, shut out a lot of people. There may be some, and this was discussed on the bill, that there may be some legislators that may be redistricted right out of their legislative districts.
Amazing.
That's how bad it is.
Amazing.
That they really want to do this. And unfortunately, it went through. It passed. So now what's going to happen is, I believe it passed the Senate as well. So if the governor signs it, if he agrees with the process, it's going to happen. And that one, I know, doesn't take effect until like January of 22, because it has to be voted on by the public. It has to be an amendment, a constitutional amendment, which gets voted on, I believe, at the next year. I believe if this goes through, the constitutional amendment will be voted on next year. And ultimately, it will be the public's choice whether or not we go with this or not.
Our guest this morning is Assemblyman Joe DeStefano. And Joe, so gerrymandering, correct me if I'm wrong, is basically the concept of, you know, so you'll have a particular political party that has more votes than the other side, and they'll kind of draft a plan. In the case of gerrymandering, they'll draft a plan to make sure that they have their district boundaries as solidly supporting their party as possible. So they may cut entire areas of towns, you know, villages, whatever, you know, they may just cut entire areas out in order to make it so that it's very easy for them and their party to continue winning those seats. Is that an accurate?
Yes, that is totally accurate. It's like the government officials are setting instead of the people setting the plan on how they should be voting and how they should be represented, it's the other way around. It's the government setting the rules on how it's going to work. Remember, and I think a lot of people forget this in the mix, is that we work for you. Government
right.
elected officials work for the people, not the other way around.
Right.
And this is unfortunate that in a one-party rule that this is what happens where, you know, they say, you know we can suppress them even more if we do it this way. And that's exactly what's going on. There's no safeguards in place. This is going to happen. The good news is, Dan, you know, to be perfectly upfront, is that the public has to vote on it.
Right.
It's like any other constitutional amendment. The public needs to vote for it. It's gonna be the same thing like some of those other, you know, the Constitution that we did a couple of years back. It's gonna be one of those movements where there's gonna be a lot of money poured into this on both sides to make people understand that point of view or the other point of view.
Right.
But it's like the Constitution that we voted down, you know, a couple of years back. It's going to be a similar kind of fight because, think about it, if you want to be represented by the people that you currently are being represented, next time around, you may not be able to be represented by that person.
Sure. So you have a value set that aligns with a particular political party, and then a different political party pushes your ability to get a representative that represents your view because they drew the map in such a way that more people surrounding you have a value set with the other political party.
To give you an example of what you're talking about, in my district, because I'll only talk about my district, I'll never talk about anybody else's district, I have the Tri-Hamlet area, which includes Mastic Beach and Shirley.
Right.
If you looked at my map, you will see that I am on the west end, the west side of the William Floyd Parkway. I do not have, but on the east side of the William Floyd Parkway, I do not have. That belongs to Assemblyman Thiel. I don't know how you figure that out. You know how you have to bypass my district to get to his district, which you should be able to do, but he has to come the other way and go through my district to get back into his district. That makes absolutely no sense to anybody. So I have no idea. I know why it was done, because that part of it was redistricted back in Superstorm Sandy. So they were looking to get a different candidate in, so they made the boundaries different so that other person would be able to win, and guess what? He won. So, you know, it happens frequently, but it only can happen when they do the redistricting, which was in 2010, I believe, or 2012.
Yeah, so and that is the big concern with redistricting in general, is if you have people who are looking to, in essence, gerrymander and limit the points of view of the constituents in that district as being represented by the party that best represents their value set.
Right.
So, you know, moving on to... You know, I feel like it's all just bad news this morning, but, you know, just moving on to checks and balances in Albany, you know, we had an executive order come out, Executive Order 202, tons of subsequent revisions. There's been new executive orders that have followed that. There needs to be checks and balances. I know that's something that, you know, has always been very important to you on whatever level you operate on, but now, you know, especially on the state level. And I know that you co-sponsored some legislation that would seek to provide some checks and balances on the governor's authority during this declaration of emergency. You want to just talk to us a little about that?
Absolutely. Unfortunately, we'll start off with more bad news. Unfortunately, on our side of the aisle, on numerous occasions, we have reached out to the other side and said, listen, we are equal branches of government. The Senate, the Assembly, and the governor's office, we are all equal branches. Why are we giving this man so much executive power to do the things that he's doing to this state? Why are you not voicing your vote? Why are you not voicing your opinion on some of these things that he's putting out that are actually hurting our state? And if you want to ask me, and you know me, I'm pretty blunt about certain things, I believe that some people are afraid to take a vote for fear of retribution. They're afraid that they may lose committee assignments. They're afraid of a bunch of things because the way it is, and you don't need me to tell you, sometimes, you know, the governor oversteps. I mean, I voted for him to have the executive powers, by the way, just so we're above board here.
Sure.
I thought that it was a great idea because, you know, there was times where there was decisions that were going to have to be made. And the reason why he was given the executive orders was because of the virus and the implications that it was going to have. And we gave him a certain amount of money, which, of course, is long gone from there. But the bottom line is, at that point, we thought it was a good idea because he had to make decisions that we couldn't all get together for and say, okay, we need to appropriate this or we need to do that. No, you make those decisions. We'll stand behind you. Then it went further. What's that thing? Give him an inch and he'll take a yard kind of a thing.
Yeah, yeah.
And every time he turned around, he was putting out a new executive order, which had absolutely nothing to do with the virus. And we were saying, well, wait a second, didn't we all agree that we were going to do this for the virus? Now you're just making all kinds of different laws and rules that are affecting people. And, you know, the three branches of government are not even involved in the process. And we've reached out numerous times, obviously to no avail. But, you know, we are going to make that a point at this coming election that, you know, we've been trying to get our branch back so that the people that we represent will have a voice. And unfortunately, at this time, it hasn't happened yet.
What's your job? That's why people elected you. Like you said earlier, you work for the people, and now you're just, you know, in a position where the work's being done and you're saying, hey, what the heck's going on here? This is not our value set. This is not what we wanted. You know, and global issues in general, like when you deal with big, sweeping, statewide things, there's always going to be winners and losers, right? So at any decision that's made is going to have a segment of the population that's upset. So that's why I think it's very important for everybody to have their representative, because different values are represented by different groups of people. So,
and unfortunately, the way the state operates, and we voted on a slew of bills this week about that, is that when bills are concocted to get in Albany, they seem to, you know, it's like a one-size-fits-all kind of a thing. And, you know, what's great for New York City is not great for Long Island. What's great for New York City is not great for the farmers and the agricultural community. You know, and that's we have farms out here, too, by the way, you know, in case anybody was wondering. I have a few in my own district.
Right.
The bottom line is that when they craft a bill, it always seems to be a one-size-fits-all kind of a thing, and it doesn't work. In certain places, it just doesn't work. And you're right. We represent our constituents in our assembly districts, our Senate districts, and right now our voices are stymied because we have to deal with executive orders. And I can't even tell you how many emails a day I get and say, when are you guys taking back your authority? And I don't know what the answer is. And unfortunately, that executive order that was done back in March, I believe it was, it goes until April of next year. So we're going to go through another election cycle almost of having him having complete control over us unless we take it back.
You know, again, just a crushing half hour of bad news. But to end on maybe a lighter note, I know that you have been doing a lot of work in your district assisting constituents during COVID. So let's just talk a little bit about that to cap the day.
Well, I do have an upcoming event August 10th from 1 p.m. to 7 p.m. at the North Patchogue Fire Department. The address is 33 Davidson Avenue in North Patchogue, just south of Sunrise Highway. There's a shortage of blood, as everybody knows. I get text messages every single day or every other day saying there's a blood shortage, and we're hosting a blood drive, the New York Blood Center. Are going to be there. We obviously have to abide by the social distancing and things like that. Appointments are preferred. If you go to my assembly webpage or my assembly Facebook page, you'll see the particulars about what you need to do to be able to donate. If you are a donor and you can make it there, we would appreciate it. We're doing pet food drives. We're doing pantry food drives. We're just doing a lot of things to try and help our community during this crisis. If you need further information, then please don't hesitate to call my district office at 631-207-0073. And for those of you who don't know, my district office has moved. It used to be on North Ocean Avenue across from the hotel, the Radisson Hotel. I've moved to the old town offices, which is on Route 112. The address is 3245 Route 112. Building 2, Suite 6, for those of you who would like to stop by the office and discuss any issues that you may need to discuss with me.
Joe, I want to thank you for joining us this morning. I want to thank you on behalf of your district for all the PPE and sanitizer that you were able to distribute throughout this crisis and everything you're doing up on the state level to stay engaged and represent the voices from your district.
It's always a pleasure to be with you, Dan, anytime you need me.
Thanks, Joe. And to our listeners, we'll speak to you next week. We'll speak to you next week.